Hi, welcome in part 2 of this lecture about vibrational waves in crystals and phonons. And in this part we will address what phonons are actually and the heat capacity. So we will introduce phonons and the heat capacity. So we will go through the classical model, then the independent quantum oscillators, which is also known as the Einstein model. And we'll have to introduce the quantum statistics here. Then we will see that the Einstein model is not enough to explain the heat capacity. Therefore, we will move to the next model, which is the Debye model. And here we need to introduce the density of states. So a prerequisite is part one. Again, here I use Kittle as a reference. But mostly the Hoffman book. So I will take some materials of this book in these slides. So this is the last slide of part one. So we were at a point where we have seen that we did not have any information on the energy and the amplitude of vibration. So both are connected in classical mechanics by this equation. So we have now to find a way to connect actually these two, and so that the vibrational amplitude comes naturally from the theory. So we will go quantum. We will add an ingredient to our model. So we will suppose now that we have quantum mechanical oscillators, and so now, in this case, we will have a relationship. So the amplitude will be related to the total energy of the oscillators. So here, let's recall the quantum harmonic oscillator. So levels are quantized, and they obey this equation, n being the quantum number. So we can represent very easily the energy. So this is the energy scale, and we just have levels separated by h bar omega, with omega equal, as in classical mechanics, square root of gamma divided by m. So we have, for n equal 0, we have half of h bar omega. This is known as the zero point energy, and it can be explained by the uncertainty principle. So nothing is completely at rest in quantum mechanics. You always have fluctuations. So no zero energy. These we will not need. These are the representations of the wave functions for each energy. We will not need these for in our lecture. So the interesting thing is here, now we can relate the amplitude of vibration to the energy, using these energies. So let's come back to our model, taking the long chain. We had this omega of k, so only one branch, and quantized k numbers, even though still in classical mechanics. So k represents a mode. In this case, we have one branch, so only one branch, therefore only one mode, one energy, one omega. And this omega is now here. All right. So we have the energy given by this equation. So this is the energy as a function of k. So depending on k, you see that omega will be different. Therefore, the separation between the levels, which is h bar omega, will depend on k. So for large k's, of course, your h bar omega will be large because omega is large. And for very small k's, your omega is small and you will have a small h bar omega. So you have a set of different kinds of oscillators in this model. Okay, so let's define phonons. So normal mode of branch S, so this branch with wave vector k here, is in its nth, so with label for this k and this branch s, nth excited state means there are n phonons of type s for this branch with wave vector k present in the crystal. So be careful here not to confuse here. So if you have a given energy, vibrational energy, it means, let's say at k, for this k you have a given energy, let's say here, it doesn't mean that you have one phonon at this energy. It means you have 1, 2, 3, 4 phonons at energy h bar omega. Okay, this is what this means. So n is the excitation number of the normal mode, or the number of phonons of this mode. Alright, so in other words, you can say that the excitations of these oscillators are phonons. The dispersion relation is often called, so this is often called the phonon dispersion curve. H bar omega is a quanta of a phonon. K is now a quantum number, and this in fact K reflects the transitional symmetry. We have a crystal. K is coming from the crystal aspect. 0 point energy, as mentioned before, we have always fluctuations, and this means no phonons. So let's mention some analogy with the photons. Both are bosons, so bosonic excitations. Both are described by quantum mechanical harmonic oscillators, no rest mass, wave particle duality. Well, this is true for any quasi particle. So phonons are fictitious particles, also known as quasi particles. So it has a kind of momentum, so we will see that we call it the crystal momentum, h bar k, as opposed to just pure momentum, h bar k for a free particle. We will see why we call it crystal momentum, and energy h bar omega. For phonons, k vector represents a quantum state, so it's a quantum number. Phonons are bosons, one state. This means that one state can be occupied by many phonons. Alright, so now we have the tools. Let's address the heat capacity of the crystal. So let's first address the classical theories. So we have we take an atom, and it is connected to in three dimensions to many neighbors. So six neighbors. So for one vibrating atom, we have this total energy, so kinetic plus potential. So these are the kinetic energies, potential energy. So so now let's look at statistical mechanics. The equipartition theorem, in thermal equilibrium, each quadratic term in the energy has an average energy half of kBT. So here we have six terms, so that's 3 kBT in total, and that's it. So the energy is a multiple of kBT. So kB again is the Boltzmann constant. Alright, so for n atomic oscillators, the energy will be just n times what we have found, assuming classical oscillators. So let's look at the energy per mole. So it's given by this. So here we need, so per mole, this is the number of particles in 1 mole, so it is the Avogadro number. And you know that NaKB is R, the ideal gas constant. So this is our total energy. So what is the heat capacity? It's just the derivative with respect to the temperature. of the energy. So this is at constant volume. So we just take the derivative with respect to T, which is 3R, which is a constant. Which means the heat capacity does not change with temperature. And this works quite well at room temperature and above. Most solids have a constant heat capacity. However, if the measurements show that as temperature tends to zero, so does the heat capacity. So this theory doesn't work at low temperature. So this theory is known as the Dulong and Petit law. So let's compare two experiments. So these are data taken from Hoffman. This is zero, so roughly room temperature. And this is temperature of nitrogen, liquid nitrogen. So this is a classical value, Dulong Petit. And you see that roughly, it's not bad. It's quite good at room temperature. However, at nitrogen temperature, you find about everything here. So silicon is quite low. It's quite high for lead. So something is going on at low temperature, and it depends on the material. This shows a graph of the heat capacity as a function of temperature. So be careful, this is a semi-log, and also this axis is also semi-log. So you see that this is the value of Dulong Petit at high temperature, and we see that the heat capacity goes to zero when the temperature decreases. And the relationship here is a power law. So T cube. All right, so let's look now at the quantum theory. You may skip these slides. I will tell you until when you can skip, because here I derive the quantum statistics. So let's go. So the solid vibration are represented by three n independent quantum oscillators, each having energy for branch s and wave vector k given by this. Okay, so omega depends on s and k, on each branch and k, and the n also. So this is a result of statistical mechanics in thermal equilibrium at T. The ratio of the number of oscillators in the n plus 1th state to the number of them in the nth state is given by this. Okay, so it's basically the exponential of minus their separation in energy, therefore h bar omega, divided by kBT. So beta is 1 divided by kBT. Okay, so let's P of n be the probability that there are n phonons in this lattice mode, which means that the energy of that mode is n plus a half h bar omega. And the probability is proportional to exponential minus En. And En being this, it is, in this case, this one. The probability is given by that. And with this condition, of course, sum of all probabilities equal 1. So let's find out A. Alright, so sum of the P is equal 1, which means this equal 1, therefore the A is equal to that. Therefore, A equal to that, because you know the sum of this. Okay, so we get our probability like this. Then what will be interesting is to know in fact the average number of phonons. Okay, which is average of n. So by definition it is given by this. Is n probability of having n. This is the direct formula. Okay, without establishing this first, this is just the definition. Okay, so you could just compute this and find the answer. But we will use this here, so therefore it is n multiplied by p of n. So it is this, we have put the n here. This has been taken out of the sum because there is no dependence on n, okay, in this part. Alright, and again the sum here is given by that. And this one can be cancelled by one of these. So in the end you get this, and you can multiply by exponential plus beta h bar omega up and down to get what is known as the Planck distribution, which is very similar to the Bose-Einstein statistical distribution, but without chemical potential. There is no chemical potential here because the number of phonons is not fixed. There is a chemical potential when the number of bosons is fixed, like the number of helium atoms in a volume, or number of electrons, not electrons, for bosons. Okay, let's continue. Alright, so this is just to summarize. We have this. We could have started, in fact, directly from this. In some books, they just to say phonons are bosons, we use the Planck distribution, and that's it. So again, mu equals zero in this case. So the mean temperature of mod k of branches in thermal equilibrium will be given by this. So we want first to establish the energy, because to get the heat capacity, we will have to take the derivative with respect to the temperature. And you see why it is important to establish the average of the number of phonons. Okay, let's look at the total energy of the system. So we are looking at three n independent quantum oscillators, each one having this energy. So the total for three n oscillators is just the sum, and we are taking the average. Total mean thermal energy will be the sum of the averages, and therefore the sum of this expression. Alright, we could have again done a direct calculation using this formula. This just gives you the average energy, and this is the partition function. So let's see the Einstein model for the heat capacity. So remember, we always start from simple and we get to more complicated. So Einstein started simple. So he chose the independent oscillators, but quantum. The only thing he changed actually from classical was using quantum oscillators. And so he took the same frequency for all oscillators. So you cannot be more simple than that. And this is called the Einstein frequency. So so the energy of one oscillator is just this. And for three Na oscillators in one mole, we just get three Na. And we take the average, so the average is on the number of excitations. Alright, so now using the Planck distribution that we have established, but in most books they say it is a job of statistical mechanics, we can just drop it directly, which is this. Therefore, our average energy, total average energy, is this. It's quite simple. Alright, so we get the heat capacity by taking the derivative with respect to the temperature, which gives you this formula. So it has a contribution in 1 over t squared. word here, but here you have exponential functions in this factor here. So plotting this and fitting, there is a fitting parameter which is omega e. Okay, so you fit that to your experimental data shown here, and you find a very good agreement, and at least you have the Dulong petit value at high temperature, and it drops to zero as temperature goes to zero. So it works quite well. Another thing, we introduced here the Einstein temperature. So you can always, from an energy, h bar omega e, you can always define a temperature, because kBT is a an energy. Alright, so why we introduce this temperature? So this is h bar omega e divided by kBT. So if you, in this equation, if you replace T by theta of V, you will find 1 for the exponential the exponential of 1. Okay, you will get that here and here. So why this is it's just a kind of quantitative semi-quantitative way of looking at where this function does not change much anymore. Because looking at an exponential, so this one will change from, so inside the exponential it will change from, let's say at low temperature this will be very high, and it will drop to 1 at theta e. And after that, in fact, the exponential will not change much. Alright, it changes very much from infinity or very high value until 1, but then it doesn't change that much. So this function will not change very much after that, so above theta, so above the temperature, Einstein temperature. And you can see that this is normalized to Einstein temperature, so it's 1, so it's roughly here. So you see that after that, indeed, most of the change in the heat capacity was done, and then you just have a small change. All right. Let's look at very low temperature. So here we have plotted here, so in a log-log, the heat capacity and the temperature. So experiment is here. So we have seen just previously that it was T to the power 3 behavior. And the Einstein model gives you a much sharper decrease when temperature goes to zero. And so let's look at the equation. So it's written again here. So we develop this term here. So we get the square minus 2, etc. So let's take the limit when the temperature goes to zero. So inside the exponential goes to infinity, very high, so we can cancel this one. So compared to this one, this has a 2 here. And therefore we are left with exponential plus all these things divided by exponential 2, same thing, which gives you an exponential minus the thing. Okay, so basically, so you have a T here, T cube, but as you know, the exponential wins against power law. So most of this decrease will be represented actually by this exponential. Okay, so this is the reason why Einstein model does not work very well at low temperature, because of this exponential behavior. So, and the exponential is a very fast function, fast varying function. So that's why the Einstein model does not work. All right. So what does it mean physically? The heat capacity of the Einstein model is lower than the heat capacity measured. So this means that the model underestimates the amount of energy that can be stored in the solid per unit temperature. Indeed, the heat capacity C equal dE dT, therefore it is the amount of energy that can be stored per unit temperature. So if it is smaller, it means that it doesn't represent all the energy that can be stored. So it means that some oscillators that exist in the solid are not represented, not excited, but not represented by the Einstein model. So some oscillators are missing in the Einstein model. So question is, why the Einstein model works at high temperature and not at low temperature? So remember, the Einstein model takes only one omega for all oscillators. So there is no dependence on K. Remember, when we look, for example, at a long chain of atoms, we have a kind of sine or cosine function. So we do have dependence on K. But we chose to have no dependence because we chose just one omega. So it's like if we had an horizontal dispersion curve, like almost an optical branch, all right? Something that does not change much with K. So at high temperature, typically for temperatures greater than the Einstein temperature, the small spacing between energy levels is irrelevant because the energy is much greater than this the thermal energy kBT is much greater than h bar omega e. Therefore you can excite as many oscillators as you want. Therefore it works, you can store energy in the system. However, at sufficiently low temperatures, the energy level becomes too big compared to kBT. So remember, the probability of occupation of the first excited state, so from, let's say, one state to another state that is h bar omega e above. So that probability is given by exponential minus the energy divided by kBT. So if kBT becomes smaller than h bar omega e, then this probability become small. All right, and actually it tends to zero, it goes to zero. So at very low temperature, you are unable to excite these oscillators. Therefore, you cannot store energy in them. And this is in fact, if you're looking at this exponential, it is in fact the factor that was coming in the Einstein heat capacity at when we were taking the limit at low temperature. Okay. So this in fact clearly shows the problem of the Einstein model. It is that you cannot excite the Einstein oscillators at low temperature, whereas in reality you do have oscillators that can be excited. So yes, eventually we call when they cannot be excited, we say they are frozen in the ground state, so they cannot be excited, and the temperature does not change anything, it just varies with an exponential behavior. So how to correct this? We will need another model to explain what's going on at low temperature, and we will need to add oscillators that can be excited at low temperature. So how to do that? Well, ideally the best is to add a series of oscillators with frequencies going from zero to whatever value. Because we need to go to zero so that we do not have any limit in number of oscillators that can be excited. Remember that phonons are bosons, so you can put as many phonons in one oscillator. So actually take so if you take a series of oscillators whose frequencies varies from zero to a value that is enough, then you can get you can excite any oscillators, and therefore you should be able to reproduce the heat capacity. So it becomes clear that we need a distribution of frequencies. So the natural solution would be to take a dispersion relation that we have found earlier for a chain of atoms, like this one, for example. Here we have indeed a range of frequencies varying from some value to down to zero, so we can excite any oscillators in the solid. And we have here very low separations of levels at for small k's and large for high k's. Alright, so, but, we need to again keep it simple. And if you look at this function, we could take this sine function. But what do we really need? We saw that Einstein model was working well at high temperature. So at high temperature, it means when KBT is larger than H bar omega. Alright, so what we need to fit the results at low temperature are small omegas, so small values of omega. Therefore, the omega in this range will be the most important at low temperature. The other ones will be frozen out anyway, so this part will be important at low temperature. At high temperature, it won't matter because all the range of oscillators or frequencies can be excited. However, at low temperature, only the lowest energies will be excited. So it is this that is significant. And you see that here we have almost a linear relationship here. So you could say omega equal Vk, V being the speed of sound here. Okay, so we'll take, we will see that Debye uses this simple distribution of omega. Alright, so we have our energies. We have a L instead of a N here. And we have omega of k. Now omega will depend on k, and the game is to find a simple relationship omega of k. And as we have just said before, the easiest is a linear relationship, and with the speed here given by the speed of sound. So we only have a very simple relationship here. So that's the Debye approximation. Okay, so he takes only the acoustic branch. No need for something else, because anyway, an optical branch will have a high omega, and it won't help at low temperature, and it's not necessary at high temperature in the model, because you already have plenty of oscillators that can be excited. All right. So in fact, this shows that the mathematics not always represent the actual reality, because you can fit whatever you want with this model. In fact, because all you need is a distribution of frequencies. So let's introduce the Debye model. So the mean energy for one oscillator is given by this. So here we have dropped the half, because anyway, when we take the derivative, it will drop. so it is more convenient to just keep the L and drop the half. So the energy for one oscillator is given by this. So for a three dimensional solid, we need to sum all the energies. So we have to sum so three times this sum. So in fact, because we have so many energies, omegas, remember for a large solid, the delta K, the distance between K state is very small, so the distance between omega will also be very small, so in fact we will take an integral. So if we move to from a discrete sum to an integral, we will have two things coming up. So first we will have to determine the maximum frequency, and also we will have to introduce this function, which is the density of states in omega space. Alright, so remember where the free comes from, and we take, so this is Debye, omega equal vk. So two questions now remains. What is how to find so that density of states, which is dn d omega by definition, and what is this omega d? So for the Einstein model we had omega e, and for the Debye model we will have an omega d. So we will need to go from a discrete sum to an integral. So in some books it just they don't just drop the formula, so I will show how to do. So what we have is a sum as a function of k, in fact. And we want to transform the discrete sum of a k into a sum, an integral. When delta k, so the distance between the k's is small. So we must have a dk in an integral. Okay. Therefore, we need to add something else, because now the units do not match. This has a given unit, which is the same as that, and if you multiply by dk, then there is a problem. So you need this to have the dimension of 1 over k. So what is the unit of that? It's of course the inverse volume of a k space. Okay. So this thing multiplied by this has no dimension. Alright, so how to get from this to this? In fact, we multiply by 1. Okay, this is 1. And this has to be something multiplied by delta k. Alright, so it's 1, in fact, k state in volume delta k. Okay, so in 1D, delta k is just equal to 1 state between k and k plus delta k. And delta n here is just this, the dk delta k. Right? And it's because it's equal to, it has to be equal to 1 here. So in fact, here we have defined a density of state. D of k is the density of state. It is dn divided by dk. So how many states you have in a volume delta k. Alright. So let's look at our case. So the phonon, long chain in one dimension. Delta k, you can go back in part 1 if you forgot. Delta k is 2 pi over L, or 2 pi divided by n, a, where n is the number of atoms, and a is the lattice constant. So this means we have 1 k state per pi over l, therefore our dk is l divided by 2 pi. In three dimension, it is just a cube, cube of, and the side is of this length, in k space. So we get this 1 k state per this therefore in three dimensions, your density of state in k space is this. And it is, in both cases, it is fixed, it is constant. Okay, no dependence of k, so on k, so that's very convenient. Alright, so let's continue. So here actually I show you the this delta k. So this is in the case of a long one-dimensional chain. The spacing is 2 pi over a n. So this is 2 pi over a, and each the distance between each state is this. Alright. And you have just one mode in that spacing. Therefore you get one state divided by this equal that and this in three dimensions. Alright, so this is what we get. You had that sum of f of k. So density of state in k space is this. It can be taken out of the sum. You have now your delta k here. So when the volume goes to infinity, which means that the delta k goes to zero, the limit, we take the limit, so we transform the discrete sum into an integral sum, and we get this one, with the density of state d of k being this value. So remember, we said that we need the density of state in omega space. Here we have it in k space, but we need it in omega space. So how are they related? So just look at the definition. Dn is equal to d of k dk in k space, and therefore equal to g of omega d omega in omega space. So we can relate them together. So our sum on discrete sum on k can be transformed into a sum where you have this density of state in omega space, a function of k, which is itself a function of omega. So this will be finally a function of omega. So everything is about omega and not k in this. So what is our f of k of omega in our particular case for the energy? So remember this slide. This is what we want to calculate. This is a sum as a function of this, but in fact this is our f of k of omega. Alright. So this is our sum, discrete sum, that we transform into a integral form. Therefore we get this. We have our density of state, and our f of k of omega is this, and it appears here. Alright, so now we need to find that density of states in omega space. So let's look first at one dimension. So what we need to find is the number of modes or states per unit volume in omega space. Following the definition of density of states in k space and omega space, we can find that g of omega is given by this. Alright. So let's look now at the three-dimensional case. So in 3D you have kx, ky and also kz out of page. So this is a cross-sectional view in just the xy plane, and so we have a given k here, so that k is on this circle, and all these dots are k states or modes, and they are separated by 2 pi over l. Alright, so the volume of one state is delta k cube equal to that in three dimensions. So in such a case we get for the case of a cubic crystal, we get V over 8 pi cube. So now let's look at the isotropic case. Only the absolute value of the magnitude of K matters. Okay, so we can jump to spherical coordinates in this case and see what this becomes. So it becomes this. So you take the surface of the sphere, so this is just the cross section of that sphere, multiplied by delta K. Okay, so this is your new delta volume, infinitely small volume in K space. So now your g dom of omega is equal to d of K multiplied by dk cube d omega. So the dk cube becomes this. All right. So now we can look for, so d of k is given by this. What about k squared and this derivative? So we use this dispersion relation, the Debye approximation. Therefore, we can have k and this derivative. So putting this in the equation, we get this for the density of state for the Debye model. So it depends on the velocity, so on this value that we have chosen for the Debye model. So in fact, there are two ways of finding the density of space in general. So it can also be found directly from n. If you know n, that is the your total, your number of states as a function of omega, then you just take the derivative, right? If you know that function n as a function of omega, it's just a derivative. So what we have done just before is we looked inside of d omega how many dn we had. Okay, so if you do not have a function, directly a function of n, a function that gives n as a function of omega, you have to look locally in a delta, in a d omega, how many dn you have in it. Okay, it is what we have done just before. So let's do now, in our case, we can easily find the number of states as a function of omega, so let's do it. So here we have again shown in K-space the modes, or the K, the states. So this is for a value of K, in Ky, Kx, Ky, and each dot is a state. Again, the distance is between each state is 2 pi over L. So how many, so the game is to find how many states you have inside the sphere of radius k. It is just the total volume of this sphere, which is 4/3 of pi k to the power 3 divided by the volume of each state, or volume of each point, which is this cube. Right. So you divide by this cube, therefore you have the L over 2 pi cube. Okay. So this gives you n as a function of k directly. So this is n as a function of k. So again, we want n as a function of omega, but we know k as a function of omega because of this Debye approximation. All right, so you just replace that in the function and you get this. N as a function of omega, and then you just take the derivative to get your density of state as a function of omega, which is that. Alright, so let's come back to our Debye model. So we have the average energy, and we have found our density of states. So now the only thing missing is omega of d. So how to find that? Alright, so what is that limit? How to find it? Because we have a linear dispersion, but until what omega, or what k? That is the question. So we use the known number of vibrational modes, which is 3n. It's kind of normalization. So n is the number of atoms in crystals. So what we get is, in fact, the total number of modes is the integral from 0 to the maximum of the density of states, by definition of the density of states. Therefore, we just plug in g of omega that we have found before, and we take the integral. So it's just an omega squared here, so it's easy, and you will find that omega d cube is equal to this. And again, we can define double temperature using this expression. So now that we have everything, let's do the calculation. We have that. So we replace the density of states. We get this. We put outside the sum everything that does not depend on omega. So we have to integrate this nice function. So we take, we do a change of variable to have a nice function. So typically h bar omega divided by kbt has no unit, it is dimensionless, so that's perfect. So we get finally this. So it's a sum over from 0 to xd given by this of this nice function. So it's a number. And here we have this T4 dependence. So it can be written also like this, taking together things inside and using the Debye temperature. So you have nkbt, which looks like the Delong petit, if you look just at one mole. You have a 9 and a t cube divided t to the power 4. Alright, and this number. So, unfortunately, we do not know the value of this function, of this integral, so that's how far we can go. However, now we can look at high temperatures and very low temperatures, what this formula gives. So let's first look at the high temperature limit. High temperature means this is small, x is small. So we can expand exponential x, which is 1 plus x, so that one disappears with this one, and we just get an x squared in this. So it's easy to integrate, we will have an x cube, and this will disappear because theta d will be in this, and in fact in the end you get 3 nkbt for the energy. Taking the derivative, we just obtain the heat capacity equal 3R, the Dulong petit law. So it works, and it has to work anyway. We added the oscillators compared to the Einstein model, so no change for high temperature. So let's look now at the low temperature limit. So low temperature means x is large. So how can we modify this sum now? So this will be large. Alright, but this also... there is also the fact that xd will be large. Okay, because xd is just h bar omega d divided by this small thing, so it will be large. And we know the sum from 0 to infinity of this. So it is this value. So now we can have our heat capacity. We take the derivative and we find this. So R is the ideal gas constant. And we find the T cube dependence, like fitting very well with the experimental behavior. So again, why does the Bayh model work better at low temperatures than the Einstein model? We have been through this already, but we can here compare again the Einstein model with only one frequency, and the Bayh model with a series of different frequencies. So again, at low temperature, when KVT is smaller than this, then this you cannot excite them, so you get the exponential drop, reflecting the exponential probability of exciting state here. But here, because you have, in fact, with omega equal vk, you have omegas as small as you want, because you're going to zero. You can go to from zero, so you get oscillators as small as with energies as small as you want. Therefore, you always have oscillators that you can excite. So it has to work, including at low temperature. And all these oscillators don't matter at all at high temperature, because you can excite any oscillators. So that's why it works for Einstein, because it doesn't matter. If KBT is greater than omega E, then all the oscillators can be excited, and the exact series doesn't matter. You could choose like a sine wave, a sine function, instead of a linear relation. It will not change anything. So let's look again at the approximation. A linear dispersion relation, which is the most simple dependency that we could think of. In this case, the maximum vibrational frequency omega d is overestimated. If you compare that line with the slope is v, which is the speed of sound, and it corresponds to the slope of this of the cosine or sine function at low k. Okay, if you remember. So this will give you an omega which is higher than what you get with the sine function at the Brillouin zone boundary. Alright. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So optical branches are ignored. You don't need them, because we saw that what was needed is just a series of omega, of small omega. So this is again stated here. All that was needed was some oscillators with low enough energy so that they could be excited at any temperature, including very low T. That's why we had to have a function starting from zero. And since phonons are bosons, any arbitrary large number of phonons can occupy an oscillator state. Okay. So again, the exact omega of k is not important in the model. It will work anyway. So again, this shows that a working model does not always represent the reality. It works because it has the required ingredients. So these are some values of omega d for different elements. So this is taken from Kittel. So you have a wide distribution. So if you look at high values or small values, you notice that in fact we still have this. This is a classical omega for a spring. So it depends on the strength of the spring, that is in fact the strength of the bond and the mass of the atoms. So if you have a heavy, very heavy atom, you should have a low omega, especially if the bond is not so strong. So this is the case, for example, for lead. You notice that diamond has a very large omega, and this is in agreement with the small mass and the very strong bond of the carbon-carbon bond. So let's look again at this table taken from Hoffman. Room temperature, you get du petit mostly, and nitrogen temperature, lower values, but still, like lead that we have just talked about before, we have a value that is almost the same as that at room temperature, the du petit. So why is that? In fact, we have seen that omega D was small for lead, and we know that at a temperature greater than the Debye temperature, the heat capacity will not change very much anymore. So this is consistent. Because omega D is small, you need a lower temperature in order to excite all the oscillators. Therefore, once you excite all the oscillators, you don't get a significant increase in the heat capacity. So this is why this value is already high at low temperature. All right, so let's just compare with the experiments the density of states in omega space. So we have found this formula, simple formula for a cubic crystal. But so, and okay, this is a representation as a function of omega, it's a parabola. But okay, this data from Hoffman, varies this data from the experiment. So you see, you can have some accidents. But roughly, you do have oscillators all the way, so the model works quite well. So just some comments about other contributions to the heat capacity. We see with the Debye model that it looks like it's enough to explain the heat capacity. So what about free electrons? So we said at the beginning of part one that anything that can absorb thermal energy in a solid should participate in the heat capacity. So in particular, in metals, there are plenty of free electrons, so they should be able to capture that thermal energy and get excited and acquire some kinetic energy. So why is this contribution small? So what happens is that this comes from, in fact, the fact that electrons are fermions, not like phonons. With phonons, you can put as many phonons in one state. That's not the case for electrons. So when you have a bond that is filled, let's say you are close to zero K, you can, so the electrons, of course, can take some energy from the temperature and be excited above for a metal at a higher energy. But if you consider an electron that is deep in the bond, there is no space for that electron just a few kbt above, because it's already occupied by some other electrons. So it cannot make that transition, it cannot take that energy. So only the electrons that are close to the so-called Fermi energy, so only electrons which has some empty states above them, these electrons will be able to take some energy from the in the form of some kbts, alright? So that's a small fraction of electrons, in fact. So they do contribute, but we see that contribution only at very low temperature, so like milli Kelvin. And in that case, we see a contribution that is proportional to the temperature. All right. Okay, I thank you, and I hope you have found these lectures useful.